This time we will look at chapter 12. Verse 1 says there, "Now a great sign appeared in heaven, a woman clothed with the sun, with the moon under her feet, and on her head a garland of 12 stars." Now, a passage in Genesis can help us with the interpretation. In chapter 37, we read about Joseph's dream. He dreamt that the sun, the moon, and the 11 stars bowed down to him. He told it to his father and his brothers, and his father said to him, "What is this dream that you have dreamed? Shall your mother and I and your brothers indeed come to bow down to the earth before you?" Jacob, Joseph's father, understood the meaning of the dream and interpreted it correctly. The sun represented Jacob, who was later called Israel. The moon represented Rachel, who was Joseph's mother. And the 11 stars represented Joseph's 11 brothers. The 12th star in the woman's garland can be identified with Joseph himself. Now, since she is associated with the sun, the moon, and the 12 stars, it appears the sign of the woman is connected to the people of Israel, who are collectively portrayed as a woman several times in the Bible. Now we come to verse 2. "Then being with child, she cried out in labor and in pain to give birth." This imagery appears to relate to a prophecy in Isaiah that says, "As a woman with child is in pain and cries out in her pangs when she draws near the time of her delivery, so have we been in your sight, O Lord." The context of this prophecy shows that the illustration of a pregnant woman about to give birth concerns people in the land of Judah, as stated in the prophecy. The timing is just before the return of Jesus from heaven to judge the world, as shown 4 verses later, where it says, "Behold, the Lord comes out of his place to punish the inhabitants of the earth for their iniquity." Thus we understand that immediately prior to the coming of Christ, there will be people in the land of Israel who collectively are in travail. The first part of verse 3 says, "And another sign appeared in heaven. Behold, a great fiery red dragon having 7 heads." This creature symbolizes a powerful, aggressive, and deadly foe. The dragon is clearly identified in verse 9 that speaks of the great dragon, that serpent of old called the devil and Satan. In the imagery of the great dragon, we see the fierceness and cruelty of Satan. As for the dragon's 7 heads, the prophet Daniel saw in a vision a beast that had 4 heads. We are told that these heads represent kingdoms, and this provides us with a clue as to what the 7 heads on the dragon represent. We find another clue later in the Revelation. In chapter 17, it says, "The 7 heads are 7 mountains." And prophetically speaking, mountains in Scripture signify kingdoms. In Jeremiah, the Lord calls the kingdom of ancient Babylon a destroying mountain who destroys all the earth. We can see another example of a mountain signifying a kingdom in the book of Daniel, where Christ's kingdom is portrayed as a great mountain that filled the earth. The 7 heads appear therefore to be 7 kingdoms. That Satan has these heads indicates that he controls these kingdoms and uses them to try to subjugate and destroy the people of God. The 7 kingdoms, with the methods employed by Satan against God's people, seem to be, as I see it, these that follow now. Number 1, Egypt through slavery. Number 2, Assyria through invasion and exile. Number 3, Babylon, also through invasion and exile. Number 4, Media-Persia through attempted genocide by Haman. Number five, Greece through wholesale slaughter by Antiochus Epiphanes. Number six, Rome through the desolation of Jerusalem and worldwide exile. And number seven, the realm of the Antichrist through warfare. The last part of verse 3 says, and 10 horns and 7 crowns on his heads. The 10 horns are identified in chapter 17, where it says, the 10 horns which you saw are 10 kings. Thus we understand that Satan is behind these 10 rulers when they finally arise to power and give their allegiance to the Antichrist, as we shall see in chapter 13. And since the seventh head of the dragon appears to represent the realm of the Antichrist with the 10 rulers, it is most probable that John saw all 10 horns on the seventh head of the dragon. That all 7 heads on the dragon are crowned with diadems appears to mean that all these 7 kingdoms have dominion and authority in Satan's service. The first part of verse 4 says, his tail drew a third of the stars of heaven and threw them to the earth. Prophetically speaking, what is portrayed here can be related to an end-time prophecy concerning the Antichrist in the book of Daniel that tells us about a horn that grew up to the host of heaven, and it cast down some of the host and some of the stars to the ground and trampled them. The explanation is given in the same chapter where it says, he shall destroy the mighty and also the holy people. Thus, the stars of heaven portray the people of Israel, whom Satan attempts to destroy through the Antichrist. We can take note that God said to Abraham, I will multiply your descendants as the stars of the heaven. The last part of verse 4 says, and the dragon stood before the woman who was ready to give birth, to devour her child as soon as it was born. We see here that Satan wishes to destroy what God's people, Israel, was destined to bring forth. The first part of verse 5 says, she bore a child, a son, who was to rule all nations with a rod of iron. A prophecy in Isaiah also mentions the phrases a child and a son that point to Jesus. We read, for unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given. As for Jesus ruling all nations with a rod of iron, it says in the description of Christ's return to earth in chapter 19 that Jesus will strike the nations and he himself will rule them with a rod of iron. And this speaks of the firm rule of Jesus over the nations when he returns. The last part of verse 5 reads, and her child was caught up to God and to his throne. Earlier in Revelation chapter 3, Jesus said, I overcame and sat down with my Father on his throne. This happened after Christ's resurrection when he was taken up into heaven, as it says in Acts. So far we see that the male child refers to Jesus and the woman collectively portrays the Israelites from whom Jesus came according to the flesh. However, the mother and her child appear to have an additional meaning due to another layer in the prophecy. We noted in verse 2 that the woman who is in travail appears to point to certain people in the land of Israel in the last days. Another prophecy in Isaiah says, she delivered a male child, for as soon as Zion was in labor, she gave birth to her children. Here we see that the male child that is born is equated with Zion's children. And the timing of the fulfillment of this prophecy is in the last days, since 4 verses later, the second coming of Christ is portrayed, where it says, behold, the Lord will come with fire. The reference to a male child who is to rule all nations with a rod of iron appears, therefore, to not only concern Jesus, but also a body of people. Earlier in the Revelation, Jesus himself said that ruling nations with a rod of iron in the future is not only his prerogative. In chapter 2, we saw that he said, he who overcomes and keeps my works until the end, to him I will give power over the nations. He shall rule them with a rod of iron, they shall be dashed to pieces like the potter's vessels, as I also have received from my father. From this we see that the baby boy who is destined to rule the nations not only points to Jesus, but also to people who obey him, overcome sin, Satan, and the world, and they will be given power over the nations when he returns. From what we have looked at, the final application of the imagery of the woman points to people of God in the land of Israel in the end time. Her giving birth to a baby boy appears to represent the emergence of believers in the land of Israel in the last days. We can compare the concept of giving birth to believers in this sense to the experience of Paul, who wrote to the Galatian believers, "My little children, for whom I labor in birth again until Christ is formed in you." Paul wrote to the believers in Corinth and called them "my beloved children." This birthing of believers in Israel in the last days, who are destined to rule all nations in the coming kingdom, does not mean that only they will be given that privilege. What is implied is that these believers will share in ruling the nations together with all the other believers who overcome. And when the text says her child was caught up to God and to his throne, this appears to be referring to the taking of these specific believers to God's throne through martyrdom, as Christ died before being taken up to God's throne. In the continuation of the narrative in chapter 12, it says of the brethren, they did not love their lives to the death. So it appears that among the martyrs in heaven, there will be a group of believers from the land of Israel. The first part of verse 6 says, "Then the woman fled into the wilderness." We've seen that the woman represents people of God in the land of Judah in the last days, as it says in Isaiah 26. And when Jesus spoke of the end time, he said that when his followers see the abomination of desolation spoken of by Daniel the prophet standing in the holy place, then let those who are in Judea flee to the mountains. That Jesus was talking about future followers of his who would flee can be seen in that he then said, with reference to his followers, "Pray that your flight may not be in winter or on the Sabbath, for then there will be great tribulation." It appears, therefore, that the woman symbolizes end-time followers of Jesus in the area of ancient Judea or Judah who flee for safety. The picture presented here is of God protecting a believing remnant from the land of Israel in the wilderness. The last part of verse 6 says, "where she has a place prepared by God, that they should feed her there 1,260 days. This can be connected to a prophecy in Isaiah, where the Lord says, "I give waters in the wilderness and rivers in the desert to give drink to my people, my chosen." The period of time the woman spends in the wilderness equals 3.5 years, which is the length of the Great Tribulation. And this places the whole of chapter 12 in that time before the return of Christ.